Where is Lisa?
She loves with us.
I didn't see her come.
Is she in the bathroom or?
I think she's talking to Steve.
He should call her Mary. She'll show up quick.
All right, welcome to tonight's study session. The first item on the agenda is a presentation from the police department on police reserve program.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. Tonight we were coming in front of you to talk to you about our plans to restart a reserve officer program for the city of Casa Grande. And the purpose of that is to supplement and assist our sworn and non-sworn police employees in various duties. We feel that it'll provide professional sworn reserve officers to support both the patrol element and the criminal investigations division. These reserve officers will work part-time on a volunteer basis, but yet maintain their certification under the AZ Post standards. Our selection process that we have outlined is we are currently going to only appoint Casa Grande police officers who are retired in good standing. We're not going to open it up to outside agencies. We're going to first run it with our own retirees. Since we have so many of them retiring the next couple of years, we're going to evaluate the program on that. And if it is successful, then that way, at that time, we can explore bringing in people from outside. Our reasoning behind that, obviously, is the fact that we know these people. We know their work ethic. We know the good and the bad about them, the strength and the weaknesses, and they know our system. Their duties and responsibilities, as outlined in our policy, they're required to work 48 hours a calendar quarter, or 192 hours a year for service for the police department. And they have to do quarterly hours. That way we have access to them year round. They would carry out duties assigned to them by our program coordinator, who at this time would be Lieutenant Shervin. They must conform to all our uniform and appearance standards of our department. They're required to meet the training requirements applicable to a full-time sworn officer, and these training hours do not count towards their 48 hours that they have to give to the city. And they must maintain their AZ Post certification. The compensation is minimal. It's a voluntary assignment. We will provide them with some uniform items as needed. For instance, our first one that is interested in this program is currently a sergeant, and there's not going to be a rank structure in our reserve program. So obviously he would need a shirt without rank insignia. Reserves will use the weapons provided them at the time of retirement. The expected costs to the city are very minimal. Reserves will have to qualify annually, so there will be a slight increase in some ammo cost, but it's not like we're going to have 100 reserve officers. It's going to be incremental, and it'll be minimal. And as I stated, a minimal number of uniform items that will be returned to the department anytime that they separate or leave the program. I think it's important to note that we're going to continue to evaluate this program quarterly to make sure it fulfills the needs of our department and the city and remains cost effective for everybody. The benefit, just a couple easy benefits to the department and to our city. It's a minimal expense to keep years of experience and knowledge connected with our department and our younger officers. We'll be able to use reserve officers for special events, which would limit the number of current on-duty officers or officers we'd be paying overtime to. And these reserve officers would be able to assist in tasks that free up current members of our departments and allow them to complete other assignments. For instance, we currently have detectives and professional standards and even our PIO that are doing background investigations on new hires for us as well as dispatch. And with the amount of people we're losing in the drop, they're very busy doing background investigations, and this would be a perfect job that could be fulfilled by a reserve officer to meet their hours. We have a policy already created. It's a best practice that Lieutenant Shervin compiled that was sent to us through Edwards and used to be Edwards and Ginn, but our hired attorneys. And we also had this policy vetted by Brett's office, and he made some suggestions that we tweaked, and we feel that we have a pretty solid or a very solid policy in place. One thing I didn't add is the removal of people from the program. It's not an automatic, just because you retire with us, we're going to take you. And removal of the program, if someone does not fulfill their quarterly hours the first time, they will be forbidden to work any extra jobs or anything using any of our retired equipment or anything like that, or under the heading of a retired police officer. And if they fail to do it the second time, they're automatically removed from the program. We want to make sure that the benefit for this is two ways, and we're trying to even that out as much. And obviously, we want the benefit to be to our department and to our city more so than individuals. And with that, we'd answer any questions if you have any.
Matt?
You said when they work extra jobs? Is that for the city or for
independent? It's basically for themselves, but they work through these companies that contract for extra jobs for officers, and these companies don't necessarily need current police officers. They just need people that are AZ post qualified.
And so there's a requirement of 48 hours for the city every quarter. Is there a requirement to balance out the extra jobs, or is that just?
That's going to be up to the individual. They're no longer, counsel, they're no longer our employees, so it's kind of hard to dictate what they do. We just want to make sure that we get our hours from them, and that they maintain their AZ post, and that they attend the mandatory training that we require of them.
Lisa? Or Lisa, Donna, I'm sorry. I'm looking at Lisa and
Lisa wasn't married. So a couple questions, Chief, on the training hours that they have to do. If there's cost involved in specific training, are we going to be responsible for that, or is it more in-house training?
It's all in-house training that they'll have to do. The only cost that I can foresee, and Scott, jump in if I'm wrong, if you see it's wrong, is for the ammunition, for the qualifications. But we will not be doing specialized training for the reserve officers. They will train alongside our officers when we have regularly scheduled mandated in-service training.
And then the second question I had, when you talked about removal from the program, is there going to be any kind of evaluation process at the end of each year, like a written evaluation?
Yes, we talked about that. We're not going to, it's basically a pass-fail where the coordinator will write a memo to me stating that this officer has met all the requirements that we set out, that their AZ post training has been done, and how many events that they worked for the city in that year, and it will be basically a pass-fail at that time.
Thank you. Mm-hmm.
How many personnel that are added, does this help set aside the shortages that you've had in the police department from time to time?
No, and thank you, Council Powell, for bringing that up, because that is one important thing I wanted to bring up. This is not going to be used to keep us from coming to the city council and the city for more people. This they will not be answering calls in the street. They won't be in a car by themselves answering calls for service. Their job will be in-house, assisting and relieving some of our people from some of the tasks that they're given right now that keeps them away from what I would consider their primary function.
Good. Thank you.
Matt?
Sorry, one more. I thought it was neat you said about, because when you came to us a couple of years ago and you saw the shortage coming, and I appreciate that, and this is a good way to help that. I know it's not going to solve the problem. But also, will they be riding along with like maybe some of the newer officers from time to time? Is that part of the program? I mean, if it dictate if it's needed, or to kind of help just to share that knowledge maybe, or interact with them?
I think, Councilor Herman, they'll be exposed to some of the younger officers, but we don't plan on using them for anything like a field training program or anything okay. like that. We're developing, and Sergeant Tenno, who will be here tonight, is one of the ones that was very important in this. We're developing our younger officers as field training, or our officers as field trained officers, as the first step towards their ability to be supervisors in the upcoming years. So we don't have any plans of using them, the reserve officers, on the street at all, unless it would be for like a city event, like a parade, 4th of July or something, where we currently might use our volunteers or use a current member of our police department.
But we'll have a bigger base to draw from for yes. those. Okay. Yeah, and again, to go, when you brought that to our attention, it was pretty eye-opening. So I'm glad that this is another program that we're starting to benefit us.
Bob? I just wanted to make a comment and thank you for coming up with this. Just an observation on reserve programs. The general public doesn't recognize a new officer, an old officer, an experienced one, a part-time one. They see a uniformed officer and they assume they're fully trained, fully equipped. And that's always one of the challenges with the reserve program. But I appreciate you guys squaring that up right off the bat and only taking retiring officers that you know what their capabilities are. So I love it. Sounds great.
Lisa?
And I was going to piggyback on that. Of course, you know, it's so nice to take advantage of the, you know, skilled, you know, community members here. And we have people that have had this background. And so, I mean, it's great. And Lieutenant Sherman, I'm happy to hear that you're going to coordinate it. I mean, I would imagine that's going to be tough. I mean, you have a strong volunteer program already as it is, but I can see how this would be to your advantage because they're actual officers that have had years of experience. But I wanted to see if you have feelers out there to see how many people you think you'll get right off the bat. Have you been talking to some people, and any idea what you're going to start with?
They've actually been talking to me. there's a strong interest okay. in this. I do know the first four out of the first five that are scheduled to retire, I know will be in this program. And the only reason the other one isn't is that she's moving out of state. So there is a very strong interest in this program.
Great. No, I think it's great too.
Donna?
I just want to make a comment that I'm really happy to see that you're limiting to just Cass Grant officers only. And I think I mentioned I sit on the committee at Arizona League of Cities and Towns, and this is one of the topics that have come up, and there was a number of officers from other communities that sits on this that are now on council, and they felt that it would help with shortages, and I did not want that to happen, and that's why at the committee meeting I voted no, because I think that we need to be very respectful of the fact that the officers need to make sure that, you know, we have jobs when we need jobs, and there's a place for people that are retired. So I'm really happy about the fact that you're being very selective on this and you're not taking outside from other communities, because we need people that know Casa Grande and will do that. So I'm really excited about it.
Anyone else? Thank you, gentlemen. Thank you. All right, Larry, do you want to introduce the next one?
Mr. Mayor, members of the council, I'll actually start the presentation, and obviously we've asked our partners, Arizona Water Company representatives, to assist with this particular dialogue this evening. I do want council to know that there is a corresponding item that you'll be considering during the regular council meeting, item K2, but because of the length of the presentation and some of the complexities, I felt it was important for us to hold this particular discussion in a study session format. And since Chief McCrory was so expeditious in his presentation, they're even yielding an additional 15 minutes to us, right? Thank you, Chief, for that, by the way. But I am happy to introduce our partners from Arizona Water Company. We have Fred Schneider and Terry Sue Rossi, who will be presenting with me this evening on the Copper Mountain Ranch project, and I know the council is aware of the fact that staff has been working very closely with Arizona Water on a water resources plan, and it has really yielded a number of positive benefits to this point. And the council has heard in the past the demand management system that's been implemented. We're working on other other water supply policies that mayor and council will be considering as well, such as our effluent allocation policy that will be coming before the council. But as Casa Grande continues to grow, we actually, as a byproduct of this water resources planning effort, had a discussion with Arizona Water about the potential of about potential options that would open the Copper Mountain Ranch development for potential development opportunities. And so we've really been working on this. The mayor's been actively involved with this as well. He's had several discussions with the director of water resources along the way. And really tonight is just what I would consider to be just an overview of the path that we're traveling. The council action that you'll take later on during the regular council meeting is really the policy decision. Staff asking the mayor and council to support the direction that we're traveling in this partnership. But I do need to, number one, express a sincere amount of thanks to both Fred and Terry Sue for their technical expertise and really just what I consider to be brainstorming and as we've evaluated the potential options of this solution for Copper Mountain Ranch. I'm going to start Mr. Mayor and members of the council by giving a little bit of an overview of what we're going to be talking about tonight and just summarizing a bit of the development. It's been a number of years since any council has heard much on Copper Mountain Ranch. Well, 2006, I think, would have been the last time that there was any dialogue. We do have Mr. Larry Yount, who is actually a property owner in that area as well, here tonight. And so I guess I would say that, at least in my opinion, this is a policy topic that we have to work very collaboratively with the various entities that are looking for solutions in this area. And so as far as the agenda tonight, I've talked a little bit about the background information. I am going to be handing off the microphone to the folks from Arizona Water to talk about water resources and water infrastructure and a bit of the next steps, and then we'll close. Obviously, we want the mayor and council to have the opportunity to ask any questions that you might have this evening as well. So Copper Mountain Ranch, I think all of you are very familiar with the location of this particular development. It actually originated in the 80s and the 90s, where the mayor and council and the then developer actually planned a master plan community, which is actually east of Pinal Avenue in the Sacatone Mountains. It has always been really outlined as by the development community as a premier development, not only in Casa Grande but in the state. And so as we go through these slides tonight, at least the ones that I'm presenting, I want to make sure that the council is fully aware that the solutions that we're looking at today are really focused in the area of our Copper Mountain Ranch Water Company and the designation that we have there. And we've got some slides that I think will depict that a little more thoroughly for everybody. But our ultimate plan is, as we're looking through the pathway for development in this area, that we find solutions that will benefit the entire northern boundary of our community. So what you'll see on the map here, Mr. Mayor and members of the council, is actually the original development that was brought to the mayor and council in the 80s and 90s. And I think many of you are aware of the fact that we did, at that point in time, concurrently with the development plan, actually create a community facilities district. And really the primary intention of that community facilities district at the time that it was formed, as all of you know, the CFD statute actually is utilized to build enhanced communities. But there was definitely a major emphasis on water at that point in time. And so what you see here is the portion, in what I would consider in the lavender or purplish color there, you'll see the original boundaries of the development and the community facilities district as it was formed in 2000. in 2002, and I know that I believe Mr. Powell was on the council at that point in time. It's right about the time that I arrived in the organization. Mr. Huddleston was the chief of police, and so there's still a little bit of knowledge of this time, but ultimately the city acquired the Mohawk Anderson Water Companies, two water companies that were privately run at that point in time. The city actually acquired those. There are approximately 250 customers, active customers, that we still provide water to today. And so when the mayor and council are establishing rates and the like, it's really for this particular area that is highlighted in the yellow there. Again, the overall vision at that point in time was that there would be some type of a strategy and a plan that would be developed to actually utilize the designation or the water company to ultimately provide services to this northern area of our community. And so in 2002, shortly after the acquisition, the area became a member services area. We had applied through the Arizona Department of Water Resources for a designation. That designation was granted the city was awarded, or the CFD was awarded, approximately 4,113 acre feet based on groundwater physical availability in the vicinity of the Mohawk Anderson Company at that time. And this is really just, again, the designation. And so you'll see that our designation is, and it's the crosshatched section now of the map, you ultimately see the area of the Mohawk Anderson as well as the community, Copper Mountain Ranch Community Facilities District. And so the city still has that designation today. It's something that we've maintained. We've paid into the GRD as well along these many years. Again, just providing services to those roughly 250 250 active customers. Concurrent with the designation, there was a council policy to actually transfer those assets to the city at that point, and that actually happened hand in hand from a transfer from the Community Facilities District to the city of Casa Grande, and the council did that in 2003. In 2006, as the council can recall, the housing boom was in full swing at that point in time, and the property that was once identified as Copper Mountain Ranch had been assembled along with other property owners to the south. And so now you begin to see the pink, the addition of the pink area there. The mayor and council did agree, and the Community Facilities District Board did agree to expand those boundaries. And at that particular time, there was a new master plan that was being contemplated that really was focused on residential housing and a resort lifestyle in that area there. I just want to point out through this map again that the area that is in pink is currently not covered in the designation. The city did make application to expand the designation of the assured water supply into the pink area, but that particular application is still pending, obviously, in ADWR based on some of the water modeling issues that we've faced in the Pinal AMA. Most recently with the, well, and I guess I would say this as well, so roughly 2008, we saw the downturn in the economy and the situations that the nation and certainly Arizona and Casa Grande faced with the housing market. And that essentially put, really slowed down any of the planning of this particular area and within the city entirely, in fact. And so with the recent activities that have transpired in the housing market in general in Arizona and Pinal County and within our community, we have had some interest by the new owners of this since 2006. There's these various parcels have really been parceled off into four owners, and the Rise Development Group, as you can see, we've got the box there, approached the city and had talked about the potential of a partnership with the city and Arizona Water and their organization, their development organization, to try to come up with some type of options to essentially utilize the city's designation, potentially partnering with Arizona Water to provide the physical water, and they actually, the RISE group, building some level of infrastructure in this particular area, developing water infrastructure in this particular area, to really begin to spawn that. There are a number of elements that have to be met in order for something like that to transpire, and we're going to talk a little more about that here in the here in the next few minutes. But ultimately, as I said early on, at least in my mind, and I think the partners that we've got around the table will agree that this is going to have to be a collective effort with the other property owners in this area. We need to develop a vision that ultimately gets executed very concisely with the help of everybody who stands to gain in this particular development. And so, as I mentioned earlier, roughly in December 2020, our discussion with Arizona Water really commenced, and we really felt like there were some opportunities for us to at least vet with the Arizona Department of Water Resources. Some of that has been transpiring. The hope was that we ultimately would be able to have what I would consider to be a very solid solution by this time, but with just everything and the activity that are going on and the various challenges that we're faced with the Pinal AMA and the modeling, ultimately we find ourselves in a position where we're asking council to consider this memorandum of cooperation tonight with Arizona Water in advance of really having what I consider to be clear direction from the state, Arizona Department of Water Resources, but we have been very engaged with that group. They've been very cooperative in meeting with us, and so I'm feeling very positive, and I believe that there will be some opportunities to move this thing forward here in the near term. This is just a timeline, essentially what I just articulated in narrative format, so I'm not going to really go much more into this. I'm going to let both Fred and Terry Sue talk a little more about it. It does talk about what I would consider to be our phased approach to this solution. Again, we see that there will be incremental steps that will actually transpire as we provide services or find a solution for the entire northern part of our community. But ultimately, we see that it's something that can potentially be done here in the very near term. The group did, and I did express this in my request for council action item this evening, the group did establish a set of objectives that I think are very important for the mayor and council to consider tonight. I'm not going to read these in order, but ultimately what you'll find is that just in summary before I hand off the advancer here, that we see this as a potential option for us to continuing the development in Casa Grande, to develop a development that we think will be a premier development within our community. Certainly one that as we continue to attract new jobs and the manufacturing industry into the community, we're going to need places for people to live. And I don't think it's, I know many of you have articulated the fact that at least in your opinion, you would like to see not only the employees living in Casa Grande, but all the way to the executives. And we hope that if with a quality development that we can begin to see that transition begin to take place with the diversity of housing stock and at least just some of what I would consider to be the initial visions that have been articulated along the way with this development. At least in my opinion, I think staff's opinion, everyone would agree that this could really open the door to bringing what we consider to be a diversity of housing stock, as well as potential of other commercial and resort types of solutions to our fine community. But we want to do that obviously in an affordable manner. I don't think. I'll just say this, that I don't think that there's any one of the groups that becomes a partner in this when it's all said and done that could do it on their own. I don't feel that the city could do it on our own. It's something that we're going to need assistance with on the technical side and with Arizona Water from a physical water perspective, as well as with the development community that is going to be developing in that area. And so with that, I believe I'm handing the advancer to Terry Sue, who's going to talk a little bit about the water resources component of that.
This makes it
Good evening. My name is Terry Sue Rossi, and I'm the Water Resources Manager for Arizona Water Company, and it's my pleasure to be before you tonight to talk about a premier development for your community. Our job is to help the communities that we serve create their dreams. All we really do is just add water to the situation. And this is indeed a very exciting development. So I'm going to just talk a little bit about how we're expecting to provide a sustainable water supply to the area. And I'm going to begin with a guiding principle that we developed. So the city and the county, actually, and Arizona Water Company jointly went to a growing water smart workshop in February of 2020. And while we were there, we developed this guiding principle that we use in really all of the work that we're doing relative to the water resource plan. In fact, we showed you this same guiding principle when we came and talked about the demand management program. And I'm just going to read it because I want to get in the habit of doing that every time we meet to talk about these issues. That's how important this is to us. So our community, farms, and businesses need water to thrive, and we risk becoming too dependent on groundwater. But we maintained our agricultural economy on Colorado River water, meaning CAP water, and we grew our communities on groundwater, both of which are expected to decline. Therefore, in order to protect our quality of life, help meet future water needs, and grow our economy, we need to do these three things: reduce our reliance on groundwater, invest in sustainable water supplies, and use the water we have more efficiently. So part of this, part of the importance of this guiding principle was really tied to the general land use plan that you all just ended up adopting. And so within the general land use plan, as you know, there are these specific water resource goals, and we were very involved with the city in helping to develop these. And so the four goals are implementing the water conservation measures to reduce the outdoor water use, and we came to you with the demand management program. I believe last November we talked about it, and then we've implemented it in April. It's going wonderfully. And then another goal was to reduce the total water use, the per capita water use in the city of Casa Grande by 15% from 2020 levels. And the total, again, I'll show you that in a minute, actually. And then another goal is to maximize the use of effluent as an alternative to groundwater where that's appropriate. And then the fourth goal is to develop additional water supplies to reduce the dependency on groundwater. And Mayor, you can correct me if I'm wrong, but I think really Copper Mountain Ranch is really the first subdivision that would be coming, or community that would be coming up through the current general land use plan. And so they've been working very hard to try to comply with all of the goals that you see in the general land use plan. So just a little background. So this is out of the general land use plan. So this is our the projected growth in terms of population and water demand. So today, the demand is about 16,000 acre feet and about 70,000 people. And by 2050, according to the general land use plan, our demand would be about 30,000 acre feet and we'd be serving about 140,000 people. In terms of per capita water use, because you might recall that the standard is to reduce our per capita water use by 15%. So today the per capita water use, the total per capita water use is 198. The residential per capita water use is 96 if you include HOAs, and 85, I believe that, or is that 88? I can't remember if I was reading that. If you don't include the HOAs, my vision is just not quite good enough for that. it seems like I'm missing something. No, that's, I guess, the next slide. So now let's talk a little bit about the specific water resource plan for Copper Mountain Ranch that's consistent with the general land use plan. So there's three elements, and these line up with those three objectives we talked about earlier that are in the guiding principle. So we've got a demand management program, 100% reuse of reclaimed water, and securing additional water supplies. From an assured water supply perspective, and Larry was briefly mentioning this, is that we're going to rely on the designation of assured water supply based on the physical availability that is out at the Anderson Mohawk Groundwater Ranch. And we have done some hydrologic modeling out there, and the water supplies look really good out there. So that was, I think, a great purchase on the part of the city a number of years ago, and that will serve this development well. In terms of the demand management program, conservation is the foundation of Copper Mountain Ranch. They are in the process of revising their plan as we speak, their master plan, to be completely consistent with the general land use plan. So they've actually pulled out a lot of the high water use elements, including, I think, the golf course is no longer a part of that, if that's just correct, Larry. So they've eliminated a golf course from that. So they've worked pretty hard to make sure that it's in compliance with the general land use plan. The reduction, if we did a 15% reduction in the current gallons per capita per day rate, it would be 168. And the Copper Mountain Ranch right now, as it's designed, in the current, in the newer form, it would be less than 140 gallons per capita per day. So that's even more than what we would expect. It's about a 30% reduction from the current levels. So they're working really hard to be as efficient as possible. The demand management program, as you know, is the one that we just recently implemented. And so the Copper Mountain Ranch system would become a part of that existing program. And so that includes, obviously, the general land use plan elements. It includes the existing ordinances the city has already in place for low water use landscaping and other water wasting ordinances and that kind of thing. We also have a customer high water use inquiry resolution and notification process. We have conservation-oriented rate structures. We have leak detection and repair. We have a meter replacement program. And we also have the Save at Casa Grande program. And that's the program that we launched in April. And I just want to make a plug for that. And so if you have not liked our page, if you have not checked us out on Facebook or on Instagram, please do. We'd love for you to follow the Save at Casa Grande program. And then we also have the WaterWise Outside program, which we are in the process of implementing now. And we're working with your Parks and Rec staff to focus on several of the different parks. And I think one of the areas is actually City Hall as well, to figure out how to use water more efficiently on those high water use areas. As far as the water supply plan is concerned, and Larry alluded to this as well, is that they're kind of two different plans moving in concert. One is for Arizona Water Company to begin by providing water to Copper Mountain Ranch, and my boss, Fred, will be standing up in a minute and kind of describing how the infrastructure works, which will make it more obvious as to why we're doing this. And so we would be providing a combination of groundwater and recovered CAP water and potentially recovered reclaimed water. And then at some point when the Anderson Mohawk Groundwater Ranch is connected from an infrastructure perspective to our system or to Copper Mountain Ranch itself, then the city of Casa Grande would be providing the water directly with that groundwater ranch water and with reclaimed water produced at Copper Mountain Ranch and other renewable water supplies. And so the city will be the water provider even when Arizona Water Company is providing water. So Arizona Water Company will provide water to the city, and the city will serve the water to the Copper Mountain Ranch area. And this will be done within the context, the initial water supply that Arizona Water Company will provide will be done through a water supply agreement. And you'll be seeing more of this as time goes on. And these are some elements of it. So the parties will be the city and Arizona Water Company. The sources of water will be water from Arizona Water Company's water system. Types of water, again, are groundwater, recovered CAP water, and recovered reclaimed water. There'll be points of delivery that will be agreed to on the eastern end of the property near Pinal Avenue. And then everything will be master metered. So at each point of delivery, we'll know exactly how much water we're delivering to the city's water system. And then the effective date of the agreement will be starting when water service has been established until the groundwater ranch has provided the backup or the final supply. And even after the Anderson Mohawk groundwater is brought to bear, Arizona Water Company will continue to serve as a backup and redundant supply going on into the future. Some other basic terms of the agreement include that the rates will be established based on a cost of service study. We'll obviously meet all water quality standards. We're going to be relying on the designation of assured water supply, so the city will need to maintain that in good standing. And the parties will cooperate on all permits that we would need to acquire and in any annual reporting. And I think that's it for the water resource piece. And I'm going to turn it over to Fred to talk about the infrastructure.
Well, good evening. I'm Fred Schneider. I'm president of Arizona Water Company. I want to say thank you very much for having me here this evening, and I appreciate everybody providing us the opportunity to present our thoughts on Copper Mountain Ranch, and I really appreciate the partnership and the relationship that we have with the city of Casa Grande. I know I've said it before, but I firmly believe it, that we are much stronger and much smarter when we work together, and I believe that you'll see this evening in the presentation that that is just what we've done here. So kind of a pickup where kind of Larry was in looking for a path forward. So with the city's designation and our water system being adjacent to the actual project for Copper Mountain Ranch, it provided us a great opportunity to leverage the city's designation, which allowed the development to move forward with an assured water supply. And then you also use and leverage our water system that we have, which is, as you can see on the map, the blue lines were actually adjacent to and contiguous to the Copper Mountain Ranch development. And most importantly, we are probably right next door in the close proximity of the first phase of Copper Mountain Ranch that Rise Development wants to do, which is also the farthest point away from the Anderson Mohawk water system. So it really creates a great opportunity and a great partnership here. So kind of explain how the process as we envision will go forward. So the city of Casa Grande will be able to approve the plats and the project under its designation. That's the allowance for the assured water supply for the plats to get recorded. Arizona Water Company and RISE are working on infrastructure as we speak, so that we can provide water service from our system to the Copper Mountain Ranch and the city's water system to get the project up and going for a period of time to get the value of Copper Mountain Ranch large enough to where it can help fund some of that infrastructure that's needed to get water from the Anderson Mohawk system over to the Copper Mountain Ranch part of the system. Once that is done and there's the financial ability, then we'll work with the city of Casa Grande to drill additional wells, build the infrastructure and the pipelines to convey water from Anderson Mohawk, probably somewhere along down Courtson to the Desert Carmel area. That is the far west end of our water system. Thereby, we can wheel it through our system and deliver it to Copper Mountain Ranch, just as we had planned in the interim. And then that infrastructure will continue to develop until the project kind of reaches a build out and we're conveying all the water that's needed. So some of the key infrastructure we plan to use to serve Copper Mountain Ranch. We have what we call here the Scott Drive Storage Tank and Booster Station. It's off of Scott Drive, just north of Val Vista, just south of Hopi. It's about 5 million gallons of storage there. We have the ability to expand that. We have ability to move about 20 million gallons of water a day through our system, so we have quite a bit of capacity and ability to move water. Some additional assets that we have available to us. We've installed about 12,000 linear feet of 24-inch water main down McCartney, and that's from Tucker to Weaver Roads, and that's the water line that went under I-10, so we're able to move water from the east side of I-10 to the west side of I-10, which also helps move water over to Copper Mountain Ranch. With that, we bought a 5-acre parcel of property off of Overfield, about 2.5 miles north of Florence Boulevard, and that's the main purpose is to take that water, that part of the water system, convey that water west towards the main part of Casa Grande. More specifically here, we bought a 15-acre parcel for two wells, which is on the northwest corner of Early and I-10, right across from Mission Royale on the west side of I-10. And that plan is for a regional storage tank, pump station, and a well field that will move water from that area into Casa Grande. And we're currently working with Rise Development to drill two additional wells just north of that site, specifically because we bought that piece of property off of Evans. And those two wells, one's been drilled, we're doing some evaluation of it, and the second well is under construction. So I'll give you a little map of where those are at. So the piece of property on the corner of Early and I-10 with the blue triangles, which says AWC wells, that is our two planned wells on that site, and that'll be a regional storage tank booster station facility. And then the two red triangles, which says Rise Development, that's the two wells they've acquired the property for, and are currently drilling and developing those wells. And that is intended to be the water supply to get Copper Mountain Ranch started. Some ideas that we have of conveying water from Anderson Mohawk, the city system, into our system and then north into Copper Mountain Ranch. And there's a, I wouldn't say all these are needed. These are just some ideas we have of moving water. We kind of have the southern pipeline route, which is probably our preferred route. The southern area of the Anderson Mohawk system has the best water quantity and probably the best ability to move water. It's also the closest to our system, so we could phase that pipeline over a period of time as additional supplies are needed. We also have a northern route. We could move water from the northern part of the system into Copper Mountain Ranch. That one's going to be a little bit longer to construct lengthwise. And then we have, you know, possibly a pipeline between the north and south of Anderson Mohawk, which is the western connection. And then we have some pipelines we plan to construct, which is right around the eastern connector, which moves water from the main part of our system, which is Burgess Peak, to Scott Drive. So that's kind of our thought of how we'd move water from Anderson Mohawk into our system and up to Copper Mountain Ranch. So with that, I'll turn over to Larry to talk about the schedule and some of the next steps, and then answer any questions. Thank you.
Thanks, Fred.
Thank you, Fred. And Terry Sue, thank you as well. And so I guess before I get into the schedule, it's probably abundantly clear to the council at this point that there's a number of elements that really are still need to be worked out on this particular concept. I'll refer to it as a concept. We've spent a lot of resources and time bringing it to a point that we could present to the mayor and council this evening. But there are a number of steps that are still actually necessary, and so ultimately what you'll see is that we'll start with the June 21st date that we're asking the mayor and council this evening to consider the memorandum of cooperation, and I talk a little bit about that in the request for council action that the mayor and council will be considering later on this evening. Again, I think that the mayor and council would agree that you'll see that it's really written as a framework document. It really is just an understanding that Arizona Water Company and the city of Casa Grande are going to work hand in hand to ultimately come up with alternatives, knowing that we've got a development community that are going to have to actively engage as well. But I also believe that the show of force with our two entities working hand in hand just gives the development community a little clearer confidence and vision that we're ultimately on the same page with moving forward to resolve the issues that may be presented to them today. Sorry about that. So ultimately, once the memorandum of cooperation is considered and if approved, then we would be moving forward with a water supply agreement. And I know that Terry Sue talked just very briefly about that. We have not shared that with the mayor and council. We're still working on it from a draft perspective. But I think the message that I want to share this evening is that the mayor and council can essentially anticipate that there'll be several agreements as we begin to navigate this course. There'll be several different agreements that ultimately will shore up the partnership and really what I consider to be provide the pathway as we work hand in hand in solving this and opening this up for development. If those things are finalized, we believe that the development community can ultimately begin to do begin some planning and perhaps even platting as early as January of 2022. We think time is somewhat of the essence at this point in time, and so ultimately we would hope that we could meet those thresholds. Prior to that, we would envision that the mayor and council would be considering an operation and maintenance agreement. I know that in the presentation, both Terry Sue and Mr. Snyder actually talked about us utilizing some of their system to potentially wheel the water up into the Copper Mountain Ranch. We've even broadened that up a little bit broader to, in fact, talk about the potential of them essentially becoming our water department of some sort, where there's a maintenance agreement and where they're handling the maintenance and the operations of the system. And so, again, just another agreement that we would be bringing before council to consider. If things go well, then we anticipate that maybe as early as May of 2022 that development could potentially begin in that area of the eastern area of the development. And ultimately, as these things are transpiring, we would envision a plan that would allow us to begin to start to have discussions about broadening the additional infrastructure that's been discussed tonight, the additional wells and the like, as well as perhaps finding the solutions to expand, to perhaps have ADWR consider the expansion of our designation and or to find other alternatives that would potentially open up the development south or in that pink box area, I guess is how I'd refer to it, that in the map that I had shown before. And I guess, Mayor and members of the council, I would just close by indicating that there's, as I said just a minute ago, there's a lot of work that's been done, but there's certainly a lot more that needs to be done. I personally believe that working together with Arizona Water in this case shows the collective efforts to the development community, and I believe that that will perhaps stimulate their interest in getting on this wagon to ultimately for resolve in this particular area of our community. The as I said, the memorandum is somewhat specific from a policy perspective to the mayor and council to essentially agree that this is something that this council would want to prioritize and for staff to allocate their resources on. And so with that, if you've got any questions of me and or if you've got any questions of the folks from Arizona Water on the technical side, we'd be happy to entertain them.
Jeff, you have a question?
Yeah, I wish I'd have paid better attention at science, Larry, but groundwater versus the Colorado River. I understand Colorado River, it's a drought because of lack of rain and snow melt. Where does groundwater generate from? And is it going down at the same levels?
So the groundwater generally is was formed many, many centuries ago when there was a time when there was the Ice Age came down and they developed these supply sources underground. They are naturally replenished by runoff that we have through rain and coming down the mountains and that kind of thing. But groundwater is not, it's not a renewable water supply like, say, the Colorado River is, where it's collecting runoff from an entire watershed and it's concentrated into the river and comes down. So groundwater, when we prove up groundwater as a water supply, what we have to do is we have to find a volume that's large enough to serve 100 years, because it's the replenishment is very slow and it's not as significant. So when the city got its designation of assured water supply, it sought, when we say it's 4,000 acre feet a year, it's actually 4 million acre feet of water that's stored there. So that's how we make groundwater a reliable supply. And Fred and I were actually talking on the phone about the difference between a sustainable supply and a reliable water supply. And a sustainable water supply is considered usually to be a renewable water supply like the Colorado River. But the Colorado River has a somewhat unreliable, at least we're finding it to be at this time, to be less reliable than what we've expected in the past. Whereas groundwater tends to be very reliable because we're pumping it from the ground. It's not affected by the hydrology in the area. What you really want to do is create a balance between those two things. And so that's what we're proposing with Copper Mountain Ranch.
So I think I heard you just say that the groundwater supply for Copper Mountain is good for 100 years, correct?
Yes.
Okay. The other question I had, you might understand that people in Copper Mountain are going to get billed by the city for the water, and the rest of the city is going to be billed by Arizona Water Company. We're going to have a dual system. Is that correct?
No.
Mr. Mayor, members of the council, Councilmember Lavender, I cannot specifically answer exactly where their bill is going to be coming from. I know that we've had dialogue with Arizona Water about the potential of billing along the way. They are obviously governed through the Corporation Commission and are going right to have certain requirements that they have to meet. But ultimately, I think the important message that I want to send is that This is the city's designation that we're ultimately going to be using in this, and there is a probability that they would be getting billed from the city of Casa Grande as well. Is that fair?
So we won't see something like Johnson Ranch or where the utilities have been a real concern out there with runaway costs. They'll be balanced for citizens on both sides, correct?
The short answer is yes. And obviously, any type of a billing question or a rate question that would transpire, at least in this particular area, if the city would be establishing the rate, that would be something that there is a formal process that is outlined by state statute that requires citizen involvement in establishing those rates. The mayor and council would ultimately have the final say in those, but we would be following the statutes as we work through the various costs and analyses to determine what that rate might be.
Thank you. Do you want to come teach science for some of our kids? You explained it so well.
Thank you.
Mr. Powell?
Curious on the viability of Anderson Mohawk. Does the Sacatone Shelf come under them where they are? Are they limited in hydrology, or are they okay?
So we've done a number of hydrologic studies on Anderson Mohawk, and the CFD, I guess, or the city at the time, or in cooperation, y'all did a lot of hydrologic studies at that time. The Anderson Mohawk is a considerable distance from the Sacatone Mountains, and so
okay. The
aquifer or the bedrock is pretty shallow by the Sacatone Mountains, but. I know that you would appreciate that. But it slopes down pretty quickly and gets to where there's some pretty decent alluvial area where the pumping is pretty good, actually. And we've done some recent looking at the Anderson Mohawk area, and we feel that area is really good from a transmissivity perspective, meaning that we can draw the water out pretty easily, and that the volume of water is there. Another benefit of the Anderson Mohawk area is that it's also a lot of that area is within the Maricopa Stanfield Irrigation District, which is a groundwater savings facility, and so we can deliver water to the groundwater savings facility and recover it within Anderson Mohawk. So that's an added benefit in addition to the groundwater supply that's available. But yes, we believe that the groundwater supply is sufficient based on what we see.
Thank you.
Thank you, Terry Sue. Matt?
We had a few things. And this is probably, I think, one of the things that would be farther down the road, but the infrastructure in Copper Mountain Ranch would be done by the CFD, correct? Is the plan right now?
Mr. Mayor, Councilmember Herman, I would envision that it would be done through a combination of development infrastructure as well as through the CFD.
Okay. And again, that what we're doing is a structure tonight, so we'll hammer out all those details as
right.
we get closer. And I think the important thing here, or a neat thing here, is that Copper Mountain Ranch is going to be the new gateway, and that's one of our goals, is to make nice gateways into town, and this is a good place for it right when you get off the freeway. And a couple other things I heard that I liked was, you know, Mr. Schneider said, I like it when we work together, and so do we, because it's been a long time before you got here, but it's been very good lately, so we appreciate that. And I like how Larry threw in at the end that, you know, it would be great if you served and maintained our infrastructure at our water company. So just remember that. That was a good one, Larry. I like how you snuck it in. But, you know, and starting a development like this with the aspirational type housing, you know, because we're doing a lot of workforce stuff now, but this would be more of an aspirational type development for people to move up to or to attract those higher end buyers that we're losing to the valley now, especially, you know, the executives in these companies. So this is a great way to do it. And with the demand management program front-loaded on this, it meets all of our goals, and it'll be the rule rather than the exception in this development. So I just like how everything's kind of working together with the developers, Arizona Water, and us, and making, you know, a great entryway and a great premier development in Casa Grande. So I hope it works out very well.
Lisa?
I agree. But I know, you know, when we look at what we're actually going to be voting on, the memorandum of cooperation, and of course this is something that, I mean, it's so exciting to see us moving forward, and the timing is perfect here. But it looks, I mean, we do have a long road ahead, it looks like, Larry.
Yes.
And when you look at the memorandum, you know, it talks about, you know, the need to prepare and formally consider various long-term, you know, maintenance infrastructure supply agreements. So it looks like this is just kind of a starting point to say, hey, we're going to cooperate, work together, and then kind of work through different things that are come our way to make sure that we can move forward together on this. So, but no, I'm excited. Mayor, I know you've been working on this a lot with Larry, but no, I think it's a great project and something that I know the community is going to be really excited. I know they're going to be ready for it tomorrow. Mm-hmm. You know, they're going to think they can buy a house tomorrow, but we have to be patient. But I think it's a pretty aggressive timeline. But, you know, hopefully we can meet that timeline. But it would be great if by next year, you know, we can move forward a little bit.
But it did start 20 years ago, too. So
exactly. Right, exactly.
Mr. Powell?
But I think it's going to be important to make sure people understand, the
Larry
timing
Young,
on it.
How does this affect your developable land? Is it in concert with it, or is there an issue? Good.
Were you done, Lisa? I'm sorry.
Yes,
I'm
going to
cut you off. Sorry. Bob?
Yes. For Larry, I think I just need clarification on a couple of things. When we talk about assured water supply, is that certificates that are assigned to Copper Mountain Ranch?
It's different.
It's a good question, and in fact, it's something that we should have probably outlined to the mayor and council early on. The designation program, and again, I'm going to look to my technical colleagues here. The designation program is a bit different than the certificate program, right? And so this entire area here that we've talked about tonight will essentially be managed by the city of Casa Grande. We will be the designated provider, and we will, as the council approves plats, we'll be responsible for allocating the designation for the development to take place. Unlike what transpires today with a certificate, where if there's a subdivision that takes place, there's another state entity that actually issues those certificates.
Okay, and is that measurable? When we look at the area of Copper Mountain Ranch, is there X number that equates to that?
Mr. Mayor, Councilmember Huddleston, my response would be that the acre feet that have been allocated and approved in the designation will not provide sufficient supply for the entire area of Copper Mountain Ranch. There is additional work that's going to need to be done to, in fact, either expand the designation and we then have control of it, and or additional work that would have to be done for it to actually position itself to be in line to receive a certificate as well. But there is additional work, but I think it's important to note that this the designation that the city has today would not provide water for the entire development.
Okay, and that's kind of where I'm going. I'm trying to visualize how deep we're digging into our bank of assured water supply. And tied to that is an observation, and of course I have to tell a story. Back in the early 90s, I was a young lieutenant, and I was handed a folder labeled Copper Mountain Ranch and tasked with coming up with a staffing study on what this area at build-out would require. And I thought we were looking at much more than 10 to 11,000 homes and a population pushing 80,000, I thought. Right. Maybe my memory's a little cloudy, but with those kind of numbers in mind and the amount of assured water that we have available, that's what I'm trying to reconcile in my mind of how deep is that need.
Right. And so I'm going to ask Fred or Terry Sue to assist me, Councilmember Huddleston, but I will start by saying that your memory is very accurate. We still have that analysis. I've got it sitting on my desk. And certainly at the time that development transpired, what I would consider to be the parameters within our Pinal AMA with ADWR and just water in general was much different. The rules that that were on the books at that point in time are much different than they are today, obviously.
Okay.
And so the city did, in fact, go through an analysis for a staffing needs analysis and ultimately a level of service analysis to provide services based on that initial master plan. But ultimately, what we're talking about here tonight is a scenario where we begin to work very cooperatively with the development community, as Mr. Yount said, perhaps bringing more people into the discussion to look for additional solutions, additional dialogue with Arizona Department of Water Resources. But ultimately, what we know that we have the pathway for is roughly, is it safe to say somewhere in the 10 to 11,000 home range? That's what we're anticipating with our existing designation today.
Okay. That helps. Thank you.
And something that I will add is the fourth element that we talked about in the general land use plan and part of our guiding principle is that we're going to acquire additional water supplies.
Right.
So you might look at the groundwater as a feeder supply. That would be the supply that would be used initially, but we would be assessing water resource fees as all the development was occurring from the beginning. And that those fees would then be used to go out and acquire additional renewable supplies so that we can keep things moving forward.
Well, and if I can as well, Terry Sue, is add the fact that I'm anticipating that effluent will become a very popular topic as we begin to go down this path, just like we're going to hear with additional development. And as I had mentioned to the mayor and council, we do envision bringing back to the mayor and council here in very short order a bit of an overview on the effluent analysis that we've been doing as part of our water resources plan. And we anticipate that there will be likely a policy of allocation because effluent will become a very important component of future development in Casa Grande in the future as well.
Okay, so it's safe to say what we're looking at tonight and what the agreement will likely spell out addresses like a first slice of Copper Mountain Ranch.
Just that one.
Because I know that area is huge. It's kind of deceiving when you look on a map and then you go out there and step it off. It's huge.
Yeah, it's big.
Phase one is big by itself.
But I appreciate that. I mean, I understand. I thought we were speculating that we had enough assured water for the whole thing, and that just it seemed out of range to me.
We believe that the pathway to the initial phases of the development that we have potential solutions that will get us to that point.
Okay.
But we ultimately understand that there's a number of other elements that would go into the broader picture for this entire development that obviously the mayor and council will be taking action on those. Well, you'll be hearing about those potential options in the future as we develop those and the like. But it's something that we see that will likely incrementally start and then perhaps with a more grander vision as the paths become clearer.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions? Well, I just want to make a comment and say thank you to Arizona Water and thank you all for all the hard work you both have done and your company has done on this. It is appreciated, and I think we have a good path forward. I think we have a good plan. I will say it's been in the works for a while, so hopefully now we can kind of get some direction from ADWR in terms of what they will allow and won't allow us to do. That'll be the next step, I believe. And then, you know, get the developers to back at the table so we can have conversations with them. I didn't see that on our map, but maybe that might be something you might want to add in terms of a potential step included in there. So that being said, thank you, everybody. We've got about 20 minutes before the city council starts. So if there are no more questions, study session is adjourned.
Good evening to tonight's council meeting on June 21st. I'll call the meeting to order. First order, two orders of business is our invocation and our Pledge of Allegiance. So if you would remain standing after the invocation tonight, we have Pastor Pat Seeler of the Calvary Chapel. Pastor?
Let's pray. Dear God, before this meeting begins, we want to bow our hearts before you and humbly acknowledge that you are the all-knowing, all-wise, and the only true God. We say thank you for the city of Casa Grande. Thank you for bringing us through the pandemic. Thank you for Mayor McFarland and each member of the council. Thank you for the economic growth and the population growth that we are experiencing. We lift up this meeting tonight, and we ask that you would give wisdom to each of those that are here and will be involved in this meeting. We pray that Casa Grande would continue to flourish. We pray that the city would always be a place where there would be healthy families, strong marriages, great local businesses, and wonderful communities of faith. We lift this meeting up to you, and we pray all of this in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Pastor. Thank you, Bob.
Yes, sir.
Let the roll call show that all council members are present.
Mayor McFarland, regarding the minutes for this meeting, I move approval for the city council regular meeting minutes from June 7th and accept for the record the fire personnel retirement board minutes from February 1st and the police personnel retirement board minutes from February 26th as presented.
Second.
All right, I have a motion and a second. All those in favor of approving the minutes as presented, please say aye.
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 Aye. Aye. Any opposed? All right, the minutes are approved. Next item is claims against the city, item D.
Mayor McFarland, I move to accept and pay the claims dated June 2nd, June 15th, 2021 as presented.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Aye. Any opposed? Okay, claims are approved. Meeting agenda approval. I do have one item that I am going to move up. I'm going to move item K2 to follow our consent agenda items. Just make a note of K2 will come after the consent agenda. Larry, any other changes by staff or anybody at the dais? Okay, seeing no other changes, then I'll entertain a motion for the agenda as amended.
So moved.
Second.
All right, I have a motion and a second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Any opposed? Okay, meeting agenda is approved. We do have a special presentation tonight. So I would like to ask Officer John Tenna to come forward. John, are you here? I'm assuming you're here because there's a lot of family members here.
Sergeant.
Or Sergeant, I'm sorry. What did I say? Officer. I said officer, but there's an officer. Or I'll meet you down here. Good. Why don't you stand over here and I'll stand over here. How's that? All right. So tonight, we want to recognize Casa Grande Police Sergeant John Tenna, who's retiring after 31 and a half years of service. 31 and a half years. Yeah. John began his career in the department on November 27, 1989. He was promoted to the rank of sergeant in September of 2001. And as you might guess, John has filled many roles in the department over the course of his career, including being the departmental quartermaster, overseeing the field officer training program, serving as sergeant of our police explorer post, and being a member of the department's peer support team. Last year, John received the special honor, receiving the police department's Supervisor of the Year award. That's amazing. John's an example of a law enforcement professional committed to public service, and we're proud that he has invested his time in Casa Grande.
And on behalf of the City Council and obviously all the citizens of Casa Grande, thank you for your service and good luck in your retirement. Anybody else want to say anything about him? This isn't a roast.
Mayor, I want to say I worked with John many, many years and on lots of different projects, lots of different incidents. He has served our community very, very well. He's put himself in direct danger many times, and we all owe him a debt of gratitude. The only thing I want to say is that's one good man right there. Yeah. Good job, John.
Again, thank you for your service.
I'd have just one quick comment, is that we are really pro police, and we appreciate the ones that serve us and the chief and his staff, and we are sorry to see you leave in one way, John, but happy for you in another. And absolutely. Thank you for all you did.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
And I wanted to say something. You know, the chief has just proposed a new reserve program, so he's looking for people.
He'll be the first sergeant on the reserve program.
The first one is police reserve. No, and you must have been, what, like 10 when you started? Because it just seems like he's so young to serve for 31 years. But congratulations.
All right. Anybody else?
You know, I just want to say I haven't had the opportunity to work with him directly, but I have worked with his daughter, Julia, and I know that she is top-notch. And so your parenting skills are above the rest, and I wish you well in your retirement.
Okay. All right, the next item on our agenda is the consent agenda. All items listed with an asterisk are considered routine matters and will be enacted by one motion and one roll call vote of council. There'll be no separate discussion of the items unless a council member or member of the public so requests, in which event the item will be removed from the consent agenda and considered in the normal sequence of the agenda. Does anybody have anything you want to remove from the consent agenda? Anyone from the audience? Okay, seeing none, then I'll entertain a motion to approve the consent agenda as presented.
So move.
Second. Sorry, Donna.
All right, I have a motion and a second. Gloria, can I please get a roll call vote?
Councilmember Lavender.
Yes.
Councilmember McBride.
Yes.
Councilmember Fitzgibbons.
Yes.
Councilmember Herman.
Yes.
Councilmember Powell.
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Huddleston.
Yes.
Mayor McFarland.
Yes. All right, this is where we're going to move K2 right here. So if you can all page to K2 item. This is to consider a memorandum of cooperation between the City of Casa Grande and Arizona Water Company. Mr. Rains?
Yes, Mr. Mayor, members of the council, thank you. For the public that may be watching, if you were unable to watch the study session, the mayor and council just went through roughly an hour long presentation on a concept to essentially partner to potentially provide water to the Copper Mountain Ranch development. And so staff is asking the mayor and council to consider adopting a memorandum of cooperation between the City of Casa Grande and the Arizona Water Company to establish the parameters and framework of a partnership to utilize the City of Casa Grande's designation of assured water supply to provide a potential pathway for development to transpire in portions of Copper Mountain Ranch. And as was indicated earlier, this is really just the beginning of what will likely be a bit of a journey, something that may take multiple steps. There will likely be additional agreements that will come before Mayor and Council, but ultimately the memorandum of cooperation, at least in my opinion, shows a cooperative effort between the city and the water provider that provides the water for the majority of the City of Casa Grande as we go to our development community. But as Councilwoman Fitzgibbons pointed out, we do have to manage our expectations. This is something that's just step one and likely something that will be more long-term. And so with that, Mr. Mayor, members of the council, I would pause and entertain any questions that you may have.
Does anyone have any questions? Okay, seeing none, then I'll entertain a motion to approve.
Mr. Mayor, I move to approve the memorandum of cooperation between the city and the Arizona Water Company as presented.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? All right, the memorandum is approved. Thank you, everyone. So we'll go back to our regular schedule here. So we'll go to item H, which is call to the public. This is the second meeting we've had call the public back, so welcome. It's good to see people here in the audience, and appreciate everybody's attendance. Is there anybody here who would like to speak to council? Okay, seeing no one rush up to the podium. Oh, wait.
Larry's not gonna run.
Yes.
Yes, sir. You almost missed your opportunity there. Please approach the podium and state your name and your address for us. And please remember you have 3 minutes. And also remember that since it's not agendized, we can't discuss it. We'll take your comments, and if there's a need for follow-up, then we will instruct staff to follow up.
All right.
Okay?
Okay. Well, W. James Hartfield, 875 East Jimmy Kerr Boulevard, Casa Grande, Arizona. DBA Hartfield's Tire Company. All right. Mayor McFarland, Pro Temp Huddleston, and members of the City of Casa Grande Council. This is just a little bit more information. I would put it like food for more thought. We've been working on this for a couple of months plus, and we've presented quite a bit of information to the City Council prior because of the COVID-19. We couldn't approach you all. We are working with city manager now, and we are still waiting for a potential resolution to these severe restrictions, crucial restrictions placed on Hartfield's Tires after February 1st fire. Before I just get 5 points, the reason I'm here is because we're operating at 20 to 25% inventory at the company now. For 53 plus years, we've operated between 75 and 100% in inventory. We only allow, because of these restrictions, to have between 75, 100 tires max in inventory. And we've normally had, for 53 plus years, 400 to 500, 600 tires in inventory. Unfortunately, they're adding sizes every year, multiple sizes in all different areas. And so we're losing a lot of business. It's so depressing, I don't even want to go to work. Because I'm in the business to make a profit, not to refer to my competitors. And I'm referring a lot of business. All right. Hartfield's Tires has received at least 5 financial debt sentences by our department, fire department, under the leadership of Marshal Michael. February the 2nd, day after the fire, there was a stop work, stop use placed on the front of the business, on the front door. On April 12th, code 2505.4 maximum enforcement outdoor storage piles were stated to be a minimum of 50 feet from all lines and buildings. All outdoor tire stores will be for compliance with Chapter 25 and 2000 International Code. Third financial death sentence we received on April 12th, interior tire storage area is limited to 500 square feet and AND 5 feet NIN height in accordance with Chapter 23 of the 2000 Fire International Code. The fourth financial death sentence we received was interior tire storage area is limited to 5 feet in height in accordance with Chapter 23 and International Fire Code. And the fifth financial, keyword is financial death sentences, all right? On April 12th, areas of structure open to the elements, no roof will be considered outside for the purpose of storage. I have a question. Where on God's green earth is the international code for the no roof restriction? And then if these five demands were not enough, on April 12th, we received an additional one. And it states that due to the limited information provided, and we've provided a lot of information, additional restrictions or conditions may be placed on the occupancy of Hartfield's tires. Now, point I'm making here is we have been in business 53 plus years, 53 plus. And so whether the fire department wants to accept it or not, we have some grandfather rights. Our property line, our fence is merely 25 feet from the building east and south. And then we did some research, called railroad company, because we own the building, but you can't buy the land. So they have restrictions, or they know what our property line is. We have not been utilizing 46.5 feet. So we have 71.5 feet going east and west. We have zero going north and south because we're right up against the railroad tracks. So with this demand of 50 feet minimum, it is not economically feasible for us to even try to store tires. So I want to make emphasis on that. Now, I'm not trying to pick on other tire businesses, but I've been in business too long, and I'm watching tire businesses for the last 53 plus years. We're the only tire business that are in compliance. At the time I came before you, it was 13, now it's 15. And more threatened to come in, everybody, and their grandmom and grandpa, so you didn't want to be in the tire business. Well, it's all good. But I'm looking across the city, and 10 feet is the minimum height in tire storage. It goes from 10 feet to 30 plus feet. I'm talking new tire businesses and used tire businesses on Pinnell, Florence Boulevard, Jimmy Kerr Boulevard. So, unfortunately, it appears that we've been singled out. I know they may say these other power tires didn't have no fire. Well, that's all irrelevant. We didn't try to start no fire. But we thank God that, first of all, God saved our business and the fire department. But now we got more crucial issues at hand. And we need some help to get this resolved. I try to do everything legal, all right? Part of my mind tells me, Hartfield, just put your tires back over there like they was and move forward and wait for the results. But I'm trying to come to you all so we can work this thing out. You know, they didn't place me as a pastor after the death of my father, so I try to do the right thing as by much as possible, by any legal means necessary. Malcolm X had a statement, by any means necessary. I put a clause in that. We try to keep it legal. And then we are farmers, too. And the farmers got to stand, we're going to be fighting till the cows leave home and come back multiple times. I've been fighting all my pre-adult life for people's rights for 35 years as a political activist. So I'm basically trying to come to you all in a reasonable, and I have Sarah come behind me with some potential resolutions, but I wanted you all to know the crucialness of this issue that we're dealing with. Thank you for your time. That's my time. And unfortunately, perhaps I'll see y'all another time.
I think you took everybody else's time too. No, I'm just kidding. Well,
all right.
You're good. And then if Sarah wants to come up next, that'd be fine.
Sarah Garland, please try and stay to 3 minutes.
I won't go beyond 3 minutes. Okay. Thank you, Mayor Pro Tem Huddleston and members of the Casa Grande Council. So these are the resolutions that we proposed. I looked up the Institute Scrap Recycling Industries Fire Safety Practices, and you know, recycling storages are way more, they have way more tires than that of a normal business for tires. So, and they recommend that if a distance cannot be met, suitable alternatives should be implemented to ensure all appropriate safety measures are met. So if they're willing to work with a facility that stores multiple tires, why can't we do the same for a private business? Storage recommendations, scrap tires range between 2,005 to 5,000 square feet in size. All materials should be spaced 20 to 50 feet away from the building. Additional piles, equipments, property lines, etc. The internal temperature of all materials should not exceed 120 degrees Fahrenheit and at a depth of 6 feet. So what they're saying is that if you can't meet those recommendations, work with the person that you that has this building, this business. Buildings without roofs should be considered back stock area of mercantile occupancy that is not physically, that is physically separated from sales area and not intended to be accessible to the public, which he has done. He has made it so that that area that is not roofed, he has it to where the public cannot enter that section of the building, which decreases the likelihood that someone would start a fire by dropping cigarettes or whatever the case may be. So he has that clearly indicated as keep out, and that will help his inventory be more safe to, you know, away from the public. But what we're saying is this: if the city and the fire marshal would work with him, we can prevent, you know, the squabble that's going on, and we can also prevent future restrictions on this business. Amen. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
And Gloria, I'll give you her speaker cards because she didn't give her name, full name,
there's
and
one more
address,
mayor.
But I have it. Yeah, I've got George. Is it Masson?
Masson. My name is George David Masson. I live at 928 North Cadota Avenue. Anyway, I'm here as a friend and as a customer. And again, I've known his family since 1968. And they're a good family, and they mean to be right. When I found out about the fire, I worked with Mr. Hartfield there for 2.5 weeks without a day off. And I even had our little Mormon missionaries over there helping us clean up. But he took 3,100 tires. I delivered 3,100 tires to the Florence facility. They're the only one that would take it, take the tires. And then he had electrical problems that was required to be taken care of. And they were taken care of. And all I know is he's a gentleman who works very hard, and he's trying to meet codes in every way. And I know a lot of the tire companies who are in town, they really are not meeting code as well. But I really feel that as a business owner, he could use a little help, and I think he's respectful in every way when it comes to working with the city. So if you would please try to help him out, because you know, we're dealing with a good person and a person who means well. And I thank you guys for allowing me to say what I feel that might make a difference in this town, which I love. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, Mr. Raines, I think, you know, I know we've been, the department's been working with them. I don't know
if between you and Paul, if there's some discussion that can be had. I know that the codes are the codes, so there's some requirements that we, you know, we have our hands tied. But can we maybe work with this family to see if there is a solution, what that solution might be?
Yes.
Okay. I don't know if it's working with the railroad, if that's part of the potential solution. I would have to think that it might be. So maybe that might be something that we can take a look at. Okay. Is there anyone else? And call to the public? Okay. Then I will close the public comments and we'll move on to item I-1, consider ordinance number 3277. Chief?
Good evening, Mayor, Council. We come before you tonight with a recommendation for approval for a contract with Core Construction for the construction of a new vehicle evidence processing facility. Our staff recommends that Mayor and Council authorize the city manager to enter into a construction contract with Core Construction for the construction of a new vehicle evidence processing bay addition to the public safety facility at a guaranteed maximum price of $375,884. This project involves the construction of a new two-bay vehicle evidence collection addition, and the scope of this project also calls for the removal of existing fence enclosure and construction of a new building addition in the same location to match our existing current building. This is a carryover CIP project from last year that we weren't able to do mainly due to the COVID situation. The fiscal impact of this is the $375,884 to Core Construction, $22,500 to the architects, $7,500 to Gravity Research for a total cost of $405,634. Be able to answer any questions.
Anyone have any questions?
Just a comment, Mayor.
Go ahead, Bob.
I'm anxious to see it, and I was going to throw in that with Ted Hawkins as your project manager and Core Construction doing the project, you can't go wrong. So I'm anxious to see it.
We are too.
Yeah.
Much needed.
Good.
No other questions? Then I'll call for an ordinance number, please, Gloria.
Ordinance number 3277, an ordinance of the Council of the City of Casa Grande, Arizona, accepting a proposal from Core Construction to provide construction manager at risk services for the public safety facility vehicle evidence bay project, authorizing expenditure of public funds, authorizing the execution of a contract.
Mayor McFarland, I would move for approval of ordinance number 3277 as presented.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Gloria, can I please get a roll call vote?
Councilmember Lavender.
Yes.
Councilmember McBride.
Yes.
Councilmember Fitzgibbons.
Yes.
Councilmember Herman.
Yes.
Councilmember Powell.
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Huddleston.
Yes.
Mayor McFarland.
Yes. And before we move to the next item, Larry, I forgot to mention with regard to the tire company, the comment was made that other tire companies are non-compliant in the city of Casa Grande. Can we validate that? Because if that's not right, if they're held to a different standard than other tire companies. Okay, sorry. Back to item I-2.
Casa Grande Police Department requests authorization to enter into contracts and issue purchase orders to implement a body-worn video cameras and evidence.com program with Axon for a total price of $639,999.65 over a five-year period. Staff requests that the Mayor and City Council adopt an ordinance for the purchase of 95 Axon body-worn cameras, 97 licenses for evidence.com, and associated equipment through Axon in the amount of $639,999.65 in yearly installments as outlined in the packet you have of $126,385.53 the first year, and $128,403.53 the remaining years. We came in front of council already to discuss the body-worn cameras, so I won't belabor that fact anymore, but we'll be glad to answer any questions if you have any.
When do you think you'll have them, Chief, if we approve tonight?
You can talk. I didn't know if you wanted me to speak or not tonight. So.
It's like being on the pitcher's mound.
Anyways, it looks like once it's approved and authorized, we should be able to get the program implemented between 2 and 3 months, hopefully.
Okay. Anybody else have any questions? Lisa?
Well, just a comment. Of course, this is something that we've been talking about for years. And so I'm just really looking forward to moving forward. And obviously, this is something that all over the country is, you know, is a priority for many cities all over the country. And I really do appreciate everything you guys have done to move forward on this. We're fortunate. I know we, over the years, have been waiting to make sure that we can fund this. We know that it's a nice chunk of change here. But it is something that's good for our community and our officers. I mean, just the safety of our officers, it provides transparency to the community. You know we have a great police department, but all it takes is one incident, you know, that can, you know, cause some headlines. And so I just really appreciate everything you guys have done to move forward on this. I think the community is ready for it. And I really hope the officers are too. But based on the information you've given us, it looks like there's a lot of support and people are looking forward to it. So I just personally, because I know I've been a thorn in your spine, Chief, for a little bit on this, but you've handled it so well and made sure that you've given us the many details that we need to feel comfortable with this decision. So so thank you.
Thank you. Looking forward
to it.
Anybody else?
Mayor, could I say one thing before you go to vote? The three topics that we talked about tonight earlier, and then these two topics, I will tell council, we would not be anywhere near at this stage for any of those, if not for Lieutenant Shervin and the hard work that he's put into this and took these projects by the horn, so to speak, and has pushed them down the road. So our department owes him a lot of gratitude. And I think when these projects do, be turned out, when they're turned out and we're using them, I think the community really would owe him a big sense of gratitude for all the hard work that he's put into this, in addition to the other stuff he does.
Great. Thank you, Sergeant.
Thank you.
Thank you, Chief. All right, I'll call for an ordinance number, please, on I-2.
Ordinance number 3278. An ordinance of the Council of the City of Casa Grande, Arizona, accepting a proposal from Axon Enterprise, Inc. to provide body-worn cameras for the department and access to evidence.com, authorizing expenditure of public funds and authorizing the execution of a contract.
Mayor McFarland, I happily approve ordinance number 3278 as presented.
Second.
All right, I have a motion and a second. Can I get a roll call vote, please, Gloria?
Councilmember Lavender.
Yes.
Councilmember McBride.
Yes.
Councilmember Fitzgibbons.
Yes.
Councilmember Herman.
Yes.
Councilmember Powell.
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Huddleston.
Yes.
Mayor McFarland.
Yes. All right, next item is I-3. Consider ordinance number 3280. It's an airport lease. Kevin?
Thank you, Mayor. With your permission, I'd like to describe the next three items as one presentation. They're all airport leases. These are land leases for the construction of private hangars. These are very similar to the ones that we've presented to council in the past. So each of them have separate square footage specifications based on what the applicant is looking to build. The first one is for Jacob Mueller, and it's for lot number 4A as part of our private hangar layout plan.
And this would be to build a 4,960 square foot aircraft hangar. And this is a 30-year lease with a 10-year option. And they only lease the land. They provide the cost and construction of the facilities. And at the end of that lease period, the assets revert to the city if they so choose at that time. And so the first lease is for an amount of $2,380.80. And the fee will increase 5 cents per square foot every 5 year on that anniversary.
Is that annual or is that an annual lease?
That's an annual fee. Okay. So, so all three of these leases are good. I'll go ahead and let you move forward on that one. Do you have any questions on this one?
I just was curious whether it was an annual or what the time period was.
Yeah.
You've answered my question. Thank
okay.
you. Does anybody else have any questions on this particular one? Go ahead, Matt.
Comment, Mr. Lewis, you're not asking for money tonight, so it's pretty.
No, I'm actually making some money tonight. Not a whole lot, but it will pay off in the long run.
Okay. Then the next one?
And the next one is for John Dean, and that's for lot number 5. And that is also a 4,960 square foot aircraft hangar. The lease is identical, 30 years with a 10-year option. And the revenues associated with that is an annual fee of $2,380.80. And again, that will increase 5 cents every 5 year on that 5 year anniversary. And then the third lease is those two gentlemen, John Dean and Jacob Mueller, partnering to build a third hangar. And this is for lot 3, and that's for a 2,310 square foot hangar. Again, 40-year lease, 30 years with the 10-year option, and the revenues associated is $1,108.80 per year for that, and then that will, again, increase 5 cents per square foot on the 5 year anniversary. So, those are the three lease agreements, and we're running out of land to build those private hangars at the airport. So we're now looking at our developing our next phase of where those private hangars could be built. So with that, I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Any questions from anyone? Okay, seeing none, then we'll entertain the first one, which is item I3, and the ordinance number, please, Gloria.
Ordinance number 3280, an ordinance of the Council of the City of Casa Grande, Arizona, approving the lease of lot number 4A located at the Casa Grande Municipal Airport to Jacob Mueller as identified on the Casa Grande Municipal Airport private hangar lease area plan and authorizing the execution of a lease agreement by the city manager.
Mayor McFarland, I would move for approval of ordinance number 3280 as presented.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Gloria, can I please get a roll call vote?
Councilmember Lavender.
Yes.
Councilmember McBride.
Yes.
Councilmember Fitzgibbons.
Yes.
Councilmember Herman.
Yes.
Councilmember Powell.
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Huddleston.
Yes.
Mayor McFarland.
Yes. Next item is I4. I'll consider ordinance number 3281, please.
Ordinance number 3281, an ordinance of the Council of the City of Casa Grande, Arizona, approving the lease of lot number 5 located at the Casa Grande Municipal Airport to John Dean as identified on the Casa Grande Municipal Airport private hangar lease area plan and authorizing the execution of the lease agreement by the city manager.
Mayor McFarland, I move approval of ordinance number 3281 as presented.
Second.
All right, a motion and a second. Gloria, can I please get a roll call vote?
Councilmember Lavender.
Yes.
Councilmember McBride.
Yes.
Councilmember Fitzgibbons.
Yes.
Councilmember Herman.
Yes.
Councilmember Powell.
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Huddleston.
Yes.
Mayor McFarland.
Yes. All right, next item is I5. I'll consider an ordinance number, please.
Ordinance number 3282, An ordinance of the Council of the City of Casa Grande, Arizona, approving the lease of lot number 3 located at the Casa Grande Municipal Airport to John Dean and Jacob Mueller as identified on the Casa Grande Municipal Airport private hangar lease area plan and authorizing the execution of the lease agreement by the city manager.
Mr. Mayor, I move to approve ordinance number 3282 as presented.
Second.
All right, I have a motion and a second. Gloria, can I please get a roll call vote?
Councilmember Lavender.
Yes.
Councilmember McBride.
Yes.
Councilmember Fitzgibbons.
Yes.
Councilmember Herman.
Yes.
Councilmember Powell.
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Huddleston.
Yes.
Mayor McFarland.
Yes.
Thank you.
All right, we'll move to item K, our ordinances and resolutions and other matters to come before the council. K1, consider resolution number 5308.
I always follow Kevin every time I come.
You need to talk to your boss.
I know. So tonight where staff is recommending mayor and council approve the resolution authorizing grant applications on behalf of Casa Grande Alliance for $22,000 for the Pinal County Reentry Project, Pinal County Hispanic Council, Pinal Hispanic Council for $5,000 for their Cesar Chavez Scholarship Program, the Opportunity Tree for $15,000 for the Healthy Habits Program, and the Museum of Casa Grande for $5,000 for the Weaver Cemetery and Xeriscape Garden. Seeds of Hope for $77,331 for the Mondo Anaya Community Center for their solar panel installation. We have three city projects, the Casa Grande Arts and Humanities, $70,000 for the post-COVID return to family outdoor activity by experiencing art through play, the Casa Grande Community Development Division for $40,000 for emergency housing repair and accessibility assistance, and the Casa Grande Police Department for $30,000 for their team policing. I just wanted to note, in 2020, even with COVID, Auction awarded the city of Casa Grande $85,034.24. $15,000 went to the Opportunity Tree, $40,000 was for our emergency housing rehabilitation program, and $30,034.24 went to the forensic phone investigation equipment and training for the PD. Any questions?
Anyone? Any questions? Okay, did a good job of explaining it. No questions. All right, I'll consider resolution number, please, Gloria.
Resolution number 5308, a resolution of the Council of the City of Casa Grande, Arizona, authorizing the submission of Proposition 202 grant applications to the Auction Indian Community on behalf of various agencies for the purpose of benefiting the general public for fiscal year 21-22, authorizing the city manager to accept and execute grant agreements with the Auction Indian Community for any grants awarded to the agencies, authorizing the city finance director to accept and disperse funds as necessary, and authorizing the transfer of budget authority.
Mayor McFarland, I move to approve resolution number 5308 as presented.
Second.
All right, I have a motion and a second. Can I get a roll call vote, please?
Councilmember Lavender.
Yes.
Councilmember McBride.
Yes.
Councilmember Fitzgibbons.
Yes.
Councilmember Herman.
Yes.
Councilmember Powell.
Before I vote yes, I just want to thank so much our Indian reservations that that contribute that type of money to our community continuously. And so a big thank you to Ak Chin. And I vote yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Huddleston.
Yes.
Mayor McFarland.
Yes. And thanks to Mary for managing all this, so thank you. All right, we've already approved K2, so we'll move to K3. Consider resolution number 5309.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. This item is seeking Mayor and Council's approval for the city manager to apply for and accept American Rescue Plan Act ARPA funds from the United States Department of Treasury. The plan allocates $11.4 million to the city of Casa Grande. in compliance with Treasury and Federal Department, Federal and Treasury Department guidelines, ARPA funds may only be used for, one, to respond to the COVID-19 health emergency or its negative economic impacts, two, to provide premium pay to workers of the city that are performing essential work, or to provide grant for eligible employers that have workers who perform essential work, or three, cover government services to the extent of the loss of revenue due to the COVID-19 public health emergency, and four, make the necessary investment in water, sewer, or broadband infrastructure. Payments to the city under ARPA will be made in two tranches. The first half, 60 days after the enactment, which is really now, any time from now, and the second half, 1 year later. Since the Act does not require the city to provide the Department of Treasury with a list of projects to be funded before monies can be drawn down, staff recommends that Mayor and Council authorize the city manager to apply for and accept ARPA funds. I'll pause here for any questions.
And Larry, the plan is then to come back to City Council with some ideas, correct? That are authorized under this act.
Mr. Mayor, members of the council, that is correct. We ultimately will come back with a plan that Mayor and Council will approve and essentially be distributed within the fiscal year 22 budget.
Right. So the purpose of this is just to give Larry authorization to apply for the money. Does anybody have any questions? Okay, seeing none, then I will consider resolution, please.
Resolution number 5309, a resolution of the Council of the City of Casa Grande, Arizona, authorizing the city manager to apply for and accept American Rescue Plan Act of 2021 funds from the United States Department of Treasury, authorizing the city manager to execute all necessary documentation, authorizing the city finance director to accept and disperse funds as necessary, and authorizing the transfer of budget authority.
Mayor McFarland, I move to approve resolution number 5309 as presented.
Second.
All right, I have a motion and a second. Can I get a roll call vote, please?
Councilmember Lavender.
Yes.
Councilmember McBride.
Yes.
Councilmember Fitzgibbons.
Yes.
Councilmember Herman.
Yes.
Councilmember Powell.
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Huddleston.
Yes.
Mayor McFarland.
Yes. All right, we'll move into the public meetings, public hearings portion of the meeting tonight. First item, and actually last item, is L1.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, members of council. This item pertains to a proposal to amend the plan area development for the Los Prados PAD. See if I can get this to progress here. That one, Steve? Oh, thank you. Oh, I got it upside down. Thank you. Okay, so on the screen, the drawing on the left shows you the existing Los Prados PAD, and the graphic on the right shows you the proposed amendment. So as you can see, the proposed amendment proposes to expand the multifamily area a little bit to the north, making that commercial area smaller, and to eliminate the office land use. Even though it says for multifamily in the proposal, as you're going to see in a second, it's actually for a build-to-rent project, a bungalows project, very similar to the one that you approved at Treckle in Cottonwood. The actual density is going down. The current multifamily is approved at 15.76 dwelling units per acre. This PAD allows programs the site for 11.6 dwelling units per acre. There's actually a lot of activity within this area of Los Prados, PAD. There's a Whataburger proposed along the Florence Boulevard frontage and an Aldi's right beside it, which will fill in that commercial area between Walgreens and the Denny's. This is a little bit different look at the existing and the proposed PAD. You can see the existing one on the left and the proposed one on the right. And so, although tonight you're not ruling on the major site plan for the bungalows, that actually is scheduled to be considered by Planning Commission at their July 1st meeting, subject to City Council's approval of the zoning this evening. You can see that there's some cross-access designed for the three developments, including a new shared entrance onto Florence Boulevard. The build for rent development proposed for this site is very similar to the one proposed at Cottonwood and Treckle. In fact, it's the same land developer. They would build, if this is approved, they would build 191 single-family rental units. They would be both single and two-story homes ranging from 700 to 1,200 square feet. When staff and Planning Commission and Council consider any PAD amendments, we look to the zoning code and the review criteria for approving those amendments. And all of those review criteria have been analyzed in the staff report that was included in your request for council action. But I just want to talk about the three highlighted ones this evening briefly. So the first is the relationship of the plan to the conditions both off and on site. We interpret that to be, how is it compatible with the surrounding land uses? Does it fit into kind of the land use puzzle for the city? So you can see that planners like to use multifamily or medium density development to create a transition or a buffer between commercial and residential, single family residential neighborhoods. You can see that this kind of fits this into that scenario where we do have single family neighborhood to the south. And so this is, we think, a good transition. Directly to the south, there is still a vacant site that's programmed for multifamily. So we'll have some kind of multifamily, medium density multifamily just south of this, and then we'll transition into a single family area. There will be a 25-foot rear yard setback with this PAD, creating a little bit of a buffer on that south property. We will require an extension of Villa de Celio, which eventually will be constructed by this development and the development to the east. So that road will be extended eventually down to Sierra Parkway, creating good connectivity between Sierra Parkway and Florence Boulevard. We still will have one short link to connect with that planned multifamily development you see on the screen. As far as the general plan, this development actually falls into two separate general plan land use categories. About two-thirds of it falls, the south two-thirds falls into the neighborhoods category. The north one-third falls into the community corridor. In both of these land use categories, higher and medium density developments are allowed. In the neighborhoods, they're restricted to sites no larger than 25 acres with densities no greater than 20 dwelling units per acre. This site meets both of those criteria. And then community center, community corridor category actually allows a higher density. In summary, this project meets the density requirements of both neighborhoods and community center. Community corridor, excuse me. In terms of compliance with the zoning code, really the applicable zoning code that we have to look to here is the residential design standards for planned area developments. Again, this is a planned area development. It's being modified. It has a residential element. Even though it's shown as multifamily on the PAD,
it essentially is multiple single-family homes. It's kind of a hybrid, doesn't fit well with our existing regulations, honestly. We are trying to, at staff level, develop some specific regulations for this type of development. But for right now, we have to apply our residential design standards for PADs to these kinds of projects. This project will not meet all of the standard PAD residential design standards. I'll talk to you in a second about which specific ones they're not going to comply with, but they are asking for exceptions from those rules. Exceptions are allowed under the zoning code and under the PAD design guidelines for these two scenarios, A and B, infill development and unique designed projects. Staff believes that this development meets both of those exception requirements. So some of the specific PAD design standards that this project will not meet, and they're seeking exception from, is basically the lot size of no lots smaller than 6,000. For every lot that's smaller than 6 or less than 7, you provide an equal number of 8 or larger. Obviously, there aren't individual lots in this. This is one big lot with 191 single family for rent units. If you did the math, you'd find that equates to about 3,500 square feet of land area per dwelling unit. So it's 3,500 per dwelling unit versus the PAD would seek a typical lot size of 7,000 square feet. There's some setbacks for side yard setbacks that are typical with single family neighborhoods in our residential design standards. That they're seeking relief from. What they're asking for is that each building be allowed to be separated by 8 feet. So there's 8 foot between units, and each unit will have patios, enclosed patios, for each development. There is a requirement in our PAD residential design standards for 5 floor plans with 3 distinct elevations. They are providing the 5 floor plans, but with 2 elevations. So there'll be less variety in terms of architecture than you might see in a normal residential subdivision. Lastly, there's a requirement in our PAD, residential PADs, for every home to have a rear yard patio that's kind of integrated architecturally into the home architecture. They will not provide that. There won't be roofed patios for the rear yard. There are walled patios for each unit that provide outdoor open space, but there's not a roof cover over those patios. The Planning Commission did hold a public hearing in formal consideration of this PAD amendment, and they voted to recommend that the City Council approve the PAD amendment. If City Council approves this PAD amendment this evening, the Planning Commission will consider on their July 1st meeting the major site plan and review the major site plan for all the requirements of major site plan. And that concludes my presentation, Mr. Mayor.
Paul, the problem with this is that, it's not a problem, but our codes don't like this type of product, so we're changing that, right?
Well, it's not that our codes don't like the product. Our codes do not do a good job of addressing it because this is a new development type that's been developed in the last 5 years or so. But yes, Mr. Mayor, we are looking to amend our city code, our zoning code, actually our PAD residential design standards, to have a section just for build to rent projects. Yes, sir.
Because this is more like a apartment than it is a single family home.
Well, it strives to meet the demographic needs of folks who may be looking as an alternative to living in an apartment. That's true. Architecturally, it's still a single family home. So. But you're right, it's a hybrid.
You and I will continue to argue over that one.
Yeah, it's a hybrid.
Okay, I'm in favor of these, so don't take it that I'm not in favor of these. So
Does anybody else have some questions? Mr. Powell.
I just don't understand why we continue to put these kind of projects in PADs and then forgive everything to the person that's trying to do it. Paul, can't we start, if we're going to build this kind of thing, have specific rules for it alone so we don't have to continue to say, okay, they don't want to do this in the PAD, they don't want to do that in the PAD, and it's destroying the legitimacy of the PAD. And if they would come up with their own zoning, which would be, would seem like easy enough to do, that what they want to do that project, they would have standards that they could comply with that would not have to each time go and try to deny something that's in the PAD code. So I would love to see that happen if possible.
So Mayor McFarland, Councilman Powell, you're absolutely right, and staff is working on those types of new standards for this product. We're still gonna put them in the PAD.
Be still my heart.
We're still gonna put them in the PAD. We're just gonna have different PAD standards for this product versus a typical single family subdivision. Yes, sir.
It's coming. Matt?
So this was zoned originally for multifamily, and I mean for apartment type living, right? So this is a different alternative to that?
Correct.
And I got a question, because these keep coming up as we talk about, and I think it fills a lot of gaps in our housing product, especially in this current climate. But what do they have against the covered patios? Because it's Arizona, and I'm not sure. Not that I'm just asking, because I just think that'd be a big selling point. Because it seems like everyone, this one down south had the patios. But the last two, this developer doesn't have the covered patios on the back.
So Mayor McFarland, Councilman Herman, that's a good point. Let me just show you one graphic that might help. This is a blow up of what those rear patios look like. You can see the dash lines with the diamonds actually enclose the what the patio areas look like, okay? And you see the units and you see the patio area. Those patios are only 8 feet deep. So if you put a cover over those, they would, you know, the green space couldn't really live. It couldn't get proper amount of sun. And you'd have 100% lot coverage with structure. So it's kind of a trade-off. What we kind of see happening is that people will put, you know, colorful umbrellas out there with their patio and because they're gonna create some shade,
yeah.
Right? But if we put patio covers over each one, we'd have 100% lot coverage with structure.
That helps me out a lot, and I see it. But yeah, that there'll be some sort of patio. I mean, I'm sure they'll have some sort of restrictions onto what kind of shade people can use. But the umbrellas would look nice, different colors. So, but that answers my question. Thanks, Paul.
Mm-hmm. You're welcome.
Anybody else? Yes, Jeff.
Paul, I know we're not approving the site plan tonight, but it's. Darla Johnson been involved in identifying a safe place for bus pickup and drop off?
Mayor McFarland, Councilman Lavender, we did anticipate that question and issue. So you can see the blow up on the right, it's a detail where there's a bus drop off designed for children pickup, and where the bus would come in off the entrance drive to the west off Walmart, pick up the children, and then go out the exit out to Florence Boulevard. So that has been designed. I'm not sure if we've run that past the transportation director for the school district, but I'll make sure that we do so.
Thank you.
Any other questions?
Mayor, I'm just curious.
Donna,
about,
go ahead.
I'm just curious about the parking. I know that was discussed, but how is that going to work per, I mean, I know that we have 1, 2, and 3 bedroom.
So, Mayor McFarland, Councilwoman McBride, we're not applying our standard single family home parking to this, which probably is 2 or 3 spaces per unit, depending if there's on-street parking. We applied more of the apartment standard to this, and they've exceeded it. That's what we said as minimums. They have exceeded it. You can see, you know, the parking laid out in this plan. Now, frankly, I'm going to tell you, we're relying a little bit on the developer and his experience with building similar projects in the Phoenix metro area. We don't have any here. I'm keeping my fingers crossed that it works really well. But I'm going to have to rely on the developer's experience because he has built, you know, 6 to 10 of these in the Phoenix metro area.
Any other questions? Okay, thank you, Paul.
Thank you.
All right, this is a public hearing, so I'll open the floor to any public who is here to speak on behalf or not for this planned area development change, amendment. Is there anyone here? Okay, seeing none, then I'll close the public hearing and call for ordinance number, please, Gloria.
Ordinance number 558.09.01, an ordinance of the Council of the City of Casa Grande, Arizona, approving a major amendment to a portion of Los Bordos planned area development adopted for property generally located west of North Villa del Cielo Road and south of Florence Boulevard, Casa Grande, Arizona.
Mayor McFarland, I move to approve ordinance number 558.109.01 as presented.
Second. All right, I have a motion and a second. Gloria, can I please get a roll call vote?
Councilmember Lavender.
Yes.
Councilmember McBride.
Yes.
Councilmember Fitzgibbons.
Yes.
Councilmember Herman.
Yes.
Councilmember Powell.
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Huddleston.
Yes.
Mayor McFarland.
Yes. All right. Actually, there is one more item on our agenda. That is reports. So I'm going to start with you, Mr. Powell.
Well, I have to report basically some complaints from the community about some of the trash, like across the street from Safeway, that disfill those areas, and why they're not required as property owners to keep those cleaned out and at least semi-attractive. It looks pretty bad. It looks like a slummy area over there with all the trash on it. And that's, I'll quit with that.
Matt?
Not much tonight, but go Suns. It's a lot of fun to watch come together as a state. And also, not to talk about the same subject, but there's a neat group of people that have started independently cleaning up areas around Casa Grande, you know, and they would probably don't want to be recognized for it, but they do a lot of good work. So I think they might be targeting a certain area that was discussed earlier. So anyway, community's coming together to help out with that stuff, and it's pretty neat. So thanks.
Thank you, Matt. Lisa?
And same thing. I don't have a whole lot, but I did want to compliment, kind of piggyback on what you brought up, Matt. You know, but just our community service department, you know, with everything. I talked to Steve earlier, but, you know, there's so much going on in the community. People are using the parks. I mean, people are out there walking, using the pool, the recreation center, and, you know, our staff is doing such a great job. Of course, the community isn't doing, you know, their part in throwing away some of the trash, especially Carr McNett Park. But, you know, we have some great volunteers that are out there helping out and cleaning up. But you know, it's just, this is time for family. And I think with everything with COVID, people want to get out and do things. And, you know, we really rely on the community services department with all the different, you know, programming for the kids. And now 4th of July is coming up and the parks. And, you know, it's just so nice to see. I drive by Carr McNett. I was telling Steve earlier that I just so appreciate, he came in when we were in the middle of that. You know, we've been working on that park for years, and so he came in and really pushed that project, and it's just so nice to see all the different activities going on at that park. I mean, there's so many different things. The splash pad You know, something we've talked about for years, mm-hmm. and even this afternoon, there were so many kids out there playing in the splash pad. So I'm just so proud every time I drive by, walk by, you know, to see all those different activities, and it took so much work and effort. So I just thank everything that they're doing out there, too, to keep everything maintained and going. So thank you.
Donna?
Three quick things. First of all, kind of piggyback on what Lisa said, both libraries are back open with extended hours, and that's a really good opportunity for people to get out of the heat, and there's lots of activities for families. Second of all, there was some activity on social media this weekend that I just feel that I need to mention. And there were some folks that felt that the city was lacking in our reporting of what's being done for the homeless population. And I was disappointed in that because having been involved not as much as Lisa has been involved with, you know, some of the things going on. You know, cghelps.com has been around for a while now, and they're offering a lot of different activities. I will say that, you know, trying to be transparent, I wanted to take a look at what is the community really understanding what we've done. And we've done a lot. We've put a lot of money through CG Helps and, you know, getting that with the mayor's task force. And so, you know, in going to cghelps.com, I noticed that some of the information and the scheduling and stuff is really behind. So I hope that we will do better working with, you know, with them at CARA to let people know, because there's a lot of activities going on. There's a lot of groups doing a lot of things. And so I always encourage people before they criticize to find out exactly what we're doing. But perhaps that we need to look at how we can share our successes, because there are. But we do have a lot of people out there, but we have a lot of people helping, and I think that people do need to realize that. And the third thing, fireworks. I know it's going to come up. These fires are horrible, and I would just ask people to please be respectful of, you know, our elderly, our veterans, and our animals on the 4th of July, and, you know, please plan to celebrate some other way besides having fireworks. That's it.
Jeff?
Donna just took my issue about fireworks, but I think the Public Affairs Office has done a really good job of educating the public, and I certainly appreciate it. Happy 4th of July.
Thanks, Jeff. Bob?
Yeah, a couple of things. Mary, I told you I was going to attend the junior high school career camp last week and speak there, and I did, and even stayed for all of their presentations. It was pretty impressive. They had groups in six different areas: the ag camp, police, fire, graphic design, performing arts, and animal sciences. And of course, the city had representatives in police and fire that did a great job. They did their reports and their performances. I was really impressed. I got to share with the students that 50 years ago, I was sitting in that auditorium as a junior high student. And I had to do the math before I said that, because I couldn't quite believe it was 50 years. But anyway, that was enjoyable. Last week, I also attended a webinar put on by the CAP about the history, construction, and the management of the Central Arizona Project Canal. It was very informative, and just by coincidence, went home that night, and there was a documentary on the kind of the mechanics and the science of the Mississippi River. And Mr. Powell, they went into a lot of detail about the infrastructure that is already on the Mississippi River that I didn't have any idea of, but all the locks and the levees and all of that. And so, you know, putting two and two together, the plan that you have promoted of harvesting floodwater off the Mississippi, it doesn't only seem possible, it seems very practical and should be done. So that was it.
All right, thank you, Bob. Mm-hmm. Just to give everybody kind of an update on COVID, the numbers are now, I don't think they're reporting every day. So people are getting tired of reporting this, since it's been going now for almost a year and a half. Not quite a year and a half. But the death rates for the state are at 17,843, and that we're still at a 9.8% positivity rate in the state. And Pinal County has 901 deaths year to date with a 10.1% positivity. So, and then 85122, there hasn't been anything reported in about 2 weeks. So I think they've stopped recording by zip code. So anyway, this may be my last COVID report unless things get bad.
Let's hope it's your last.
Yeah, let's hope it's my last. Last week, I did participate in a Greater Phoenix Economic Council mayor's roundtable with two other mayors, and we were there to speak with the GPEC ambassadors, which are people from all over the Phoenix area, and we talked about economic impact, economic development, you know, what's going on in the cities, and Casa Grande should be proud of itself. We have a lot of very positive activities going on. Financially, we're strong. You know, I listened to some of the other cities and some of the issues that they're dealing with that we fortunately are not dealing with. And so I feel very fortunate to live in Casa Grande. I also attended what's called an ARC meeting. It's the Arizona Reconciliation Committee. It's a subgroup that advises the state water folks when they go and meet with the lower basin states on the Colorado River water. So it's an important subcommittee. I think we're doing some good work. There's some information that they hadn't thought about in terms of municipalities, because I'm one of the few municipal members on this committee. And so I felt pretty good about the input that we were giving them and some of the potential outcomes that may go forward as part of the advisory group. We don't make any decisions. We don't attend the big meetings, but I think we can affect policy by giving them some good ideas. One of the best ones that I felt that we were moving forward was that to come up with a solution, like Mr. Powell's example of bringing river water. They don't talk about solutions. They talk about how they're going to argue with the other six lower basin states. So I said, well, let's find a solution. Let's give them an idea on a solution, and let's come up with a fix, not how we're going to, you know, cheat California out of some Colorado River water. So it was a good meeting. I came away with it with a good feeling. Other than that, I was actually off last week, but still managed to attend a few meetings since Zoom is still around. And just wanted to wish everybody a happy 4th of July, and thank you all for being here tonight. Does anybody else have anything else you want to say?
No.
Okay.
Hasta la vista.
Meeting adjourned. Thank